Hi, I'm Eric Kelly from KellyPlanet.com, and this is a closer look at Star Trek The Next Generation, Season 1, Episode 13, DATALORE.
Our last assignment has taken us into the remote Omicron Theta star system, home of our android crew member, Lieutenant Commander Data. I have decided to visit Data's home planet in the hopes of unraveling some of the mystery of his beginning.
All right, this is a Data episode, and he is definitely one of my favorite Trek characters of all time. This starts off a decades-long tradition of Brent Spiner playing many different versions of Data's lineage. I'll save the rest of my Data rambling for later. Let's go. The Enterprise is entering orbit around Omicron Theta, and Data is in his quarters practicing sneezing.
Data! Chew!
What are you doing?
Sneezing.
Have you got a cold?
A cold what?
It's a disease my mom says people used to get.
He's not very good at it.
Ah. But humans still sneeze for other reasons. And I cannot seem to do it right.
Captain Picard wishes to see you on the bridge.
Yar reports that the planet has a Class M environment, but there is no life, not even vegetation. That's odd. They're dropping all kinds of hints about what happened to the colony where Data was discovered, but they explain more of that later, so I'll wait.
First officer's log. Stardate 4124.5.
I hate to point stuff like this out, but Riker missed a digit in his stardate. Down on the planet, the away team confirms that the surface is completely devoid of life. Not even bacteria. Something bad went down since the colony and his farmlands. The established timeline is that Data was discovered 26 years ago, and the planet's been dead since before that. Except, earlier Picard says...
The crews that found Data reported farmlands.
So something's not jiving. Data's like, yeah, this area looks familiar. Oh, yeah, the crew of the Tripoli found me right there. And at the time, he was inactive, but then he came to, so this is essentially where Data was born. Geordi uses his supervision to detect a hidden door in the rock face that leads to a hidden facility. Why would the colonists have that?
The colonists' laboratory extremely well-equipped. Hosted by proud parents.
That doesn't look good. Seems to depict the colonists getting attacked by a big snowflake in the sky. Notice Data accidentally has three solid commander pips.
At Dr. Soong's work area.
Who? You don't mean Dr. Noonien Soong.
Dr. Noonien Soong, my friend, happens to have been Earth's foremost robotic scientist.
This is the first time that we hear of Dr. Noonien Soong. Geordi says he was a robotic scientist, but he was in fact a cyberneticist. Anyway, Tasha says he was kind of exiled from Earth for trying to make Asimov's positronic brain come true. Now, at this point, no one knows that Soong created Data, but they know about Soong, and Data has a positronic brain, and no one has put two and two together in 26 years.
Data, Geordi, we'll get a close look at this lab. You and Lieutenant Worf reconnoiter where those corridors lead.
Aye, sir.
So they split up Scooby-Doo style to explore the compound. They find a bunch of stuff in the lab that makes it pretty obvious that Data was created here. Then Geordi's like, hey, someone left a fog machine on this room over here.
How many more Datas are there?
Commander. Can this be another me?
This is pretty heavy. Up until now, Data was the only life form of his kind. Riker tells him that they will take these body parts up to the ship and see if they can make them work.
We have discovered something which may explain Data's beginnings, if we can properly assemble and communicate with what we've found.
Hey, there's Chief Engineer Argyle. We haven't seen him since the 7th episode. They have a whole bunch of people trying to reassemble the other Data, but it's tough, and Argyle mentions that they may have to use Data's anatomy as a reference. Here they are discussing the potential of this other android, but everyone is kind of tiptoeing around their words. Picard says that there's no reason for this to be awkward. Data is a machine, but they are all also machines too, just in a biological sense. This makes everybody feel better.
Why was I given human form?
Well, to make it easier for humans to relate to you. Had to be.
That human-shaped robots need not be clumsy or limited. You certainly operate as well as we do, Data. Better in some ways, sir.
Picard calls him a robot. Data is not a robot, just like Soong is not into robotics. Data is an android. Riker shows Picard a drawing of the scary snowflake, and then Crusher calls up and says that they need Data's help.
Press your fingers there, Doctor.
It operates almost as a switch.
I won't mention it to anyone.
If you had an off switch, Doctor, would you not keep it secret?
So the plan is to turn Data off and open him up to see how his systems work. Does not seem like the best idea to me, nor is the fact that Data has an off switch. I'm a big proponent of giving Beverly more to do on this show, but in this case, her medical knowledge would be useless here. Everything is wrapped up, but the other android isn't awake yet. Wait.
I wonder which of them was made first.
He was. But they found him to be imperfect, and I was made to replace him.
Ho-ho! Now we have two androids, both played by Brent Spiner. Take notice to Lore's facial tic and how he plays both of these parts in a way that you can always subtly tell them apart. We're on the bridge teaching Lore about helm control. It seems a bit soon.
And the square of a hypotenuse of the right triangle
is equal to the sum of the square of the other two. To something, which I once heard but never understood.
Seems Lore may know more than he lets on. Data correctly points out that he shouldn't even be on the bridge in the first place.
Do you realize that Commander Riker's hypotenuse question tricked you into showing your knowledge was greater than you were indicating? He didn't seem that clever. I'll be more careful.
Turns out Lore lied. He was actually made first. He claims that Dr. Soong made him too perfect, too human, and this really bothered the colonists on Omicron Theta, so he created Data with more limited capabilities.
Haven't you noticed how easily I handle human speech? I use their contractions. For example, I say, can't, or isn't. And you say, cannot, and is not.
Aha! So the contraction thing is officially canon now. At this point, Data has used contractions 34 times, but not yet in this episode so far.
I say tomato, and you say tomato. I say potato, and you say potato. Yeah, a very old joke.
Lore says that's a very old joke. Yeah, very old. The tomato-tomato thing comes from a song sung by Fred Astaire and Ginger Rogers in a film called Shall We Dance from 1937. How the heck is Lore aware of this? Thanks to Lore's account, the Enterprise crew now knows what happened to the colonists, and we see the crystalline entity for the first time. That's the big old snowflake, and it consumes all the life it finds, even that of an entire planet.
But how did Data escape that thing? Or Lore?
Lore had been disassembled. He explained it as jealousy from the colonists. And Data wasn't yet alive at that time.
Which explains why Data could be left outside in no danger from that creature.
Tasha reports that Lore has left Data's quarters and is on deck 4. Data says he'll go check it out, and Crusher's like, is that how you treat your brother? Picard's like, yeah, that's because I told him to keep an eye on him. Uh-oh, what's Lore up to? Obviously, he spiked Data's drink, though I cannot imagine what he could have put in there. It acts like an android roofie.
And let us toast also the great crystal entity. Can you imagine its gratitude when I give it the life on this vessel?
Well, this isn't good. Worf has detected a subspace signal being transmitted from Data's quarters, so they send Wesley to check it out. Okay. Of course, it's not actually Data. Lore has switched clothing with him to take his place and is sending a message to the big snowflake to inform it as much.
Lore suddenly attacked me and I had to turn him off. He discovered we have been using sensors to follow what he does.
If you'd said we've been using the sensors instead of we have, I might have suspected you were Lore.
Wesley falls for this. Since the facial tic is a dead giveaway, Lore uses a magic flashlight to give Data one and to remove his own. So Lore is running around as Data and uh-oh.
Captain, I'm picking up a bogey coming in on a 5 o'clock tangent.
Shields up, go to yellow alert. Transmit friendly greetings, all languages, all frequencies.
I recognize it, sir. It's the crystal image Lore described.
My God.
Yep, it's the big scary snowflake. Where the heck was Geordi? He was just on the bridge a second ago. Picard asks Data to go question Lore for more information about the snowflake, and Wesley's like, yeah, I suggest you don't let him roam around freely. Lore's like, hey, no problem, you can come with me. Riker gives Wesley some crap about disrespecting a senior officer and decides to go along too.
Stay back. We may have problems if he senses someone else is near. I cannot control him if you stay. Please, I will record everything he says.
And you bring it to the bridge immediately.
Lore tells Riker and Wesley that he cannot control Data if they stay, and they fall for that.
It was Laura, sir. Same facial twitches that we've seen all along, lying unconscious on the floor exactly as Data had described, and then it suddenly became violent, apparently sensing that Wesley and I were present.
Or is it Laura pretending to be Data and faking it all?
This has got to be the first time I can honestly say they should listen to Wesley, but of course they don't. And now the scary snowflake is trying to penetrate the Enterprise's shields. Worf's about ready to blast it with photon torpedoes, and Laura's like, Captain, let me talk to it.
Affirmative, talk to it. Open hailing frequencies.
Crystal form. I identify myself as Data, advising you to stop your attack.
So the plan, get this, is to make a show of force by beaming a tree out next to the snowflake and then blowing it up. What? That's nuts. But Picard's like, oh yeah, go ahead. Worf goes to check on what Lore is doing, and he beats the crap out of him in the turbo lift. Poor Worf, anytime they need to show a character is strong, he takes a beating. Wesley is sticking to his guns and convinces his mom to check out what she thinks is Lore, but of course Wesley is correct, and Beverly uses the secret switch to turn Data back on.
Data, the crystal thing is outside somewhere close to the ship, and Lore's loose on the inside.
How badly are you hurt, Data?
I will function sufficiently to stop Lore, Doctor.
Laura's in the cargo bay talking to the scary snowflake about consuming the Enterprise's crew, and Data's there to stop him.
How sad, dear brother. You make me wish I were an only child. The troublesome little man-child. Are you prepared for the kind of death you've earned, little man?
If you take one more step towards my son.
Somehow Lore pulls off this maneuver and is now on top of the situation. He tells the doc to get the heck out of there, and in return he may not kill Wesley. Data's like, go doc, I've got this. But Lore shoots her anyway. Android fight! This is actually pretty cool. Obviously those containers are empty, but Spiner does a great job. Data manages to toss Lore onto the transporter, and Wesley beams him off the ship. I'm not sure how the transporter interrupted the phaser beam, but hey, whatever.
Lore's gone, sir. Permanently.
Doctor, now that Wesley's safe, go to sickbay at once.
Captain, the crystal thing has begun to move away.
With all the Data Lore switcheroo and Lore being able to use contractions, my counter didn't get any new ones until...
Data, you all right?
Yes, sir. I'm fine.
And get rid of that damn twitch.
Data said, I'm...
Number one, have you ever considered whether Data is more human or less human than we want?
I only wish we were all as well balanced, sir.
Agreed.
This one was tough for me to write. I actually had to stop, go to bed, and pick it up the next day. There is so much going on here. I have 35 years of superfan knowledge that applies, but back in 1988, there was so much we didn't know yet. Where did Data come from? Who or what created him? We didn't know this. This is the first time we hear about Dr. Noonien Soong or the colony on Omicron Theta. This is the first appearance of the crystalline entity, let alone Lore. All this stuff comes up again over the next several decades. I didn't include it here, but they do mention that Data has the collective knowledge and memories in the form of personal logs of all the colonists. This isn't an issue in this episode, but it will be a plot point in the future. Of course, Brent Spiner plays both Data and Lore, and I think he does a great job, and this is just the beginning. He also plays several versions of Noonien Soong. He was a whole bunch of different characters in the Fistful of Data's holodeck episode. He was B4 in Nemesis, Arik Soong in Enterprise, Altan Inigo Soong, and Adam Soong in Picard, and there's probably more that I haven't memorized yet. My contraction counter is up to 35, and the contraction thing is now officially part of canon. That was Star Trek The Next Generation, Season 1, Episode 13. I'm Eric Kelly from KellyPlanet.com. Live long and prosper. Hi, it's me again, and if you liked that video, please hit the button so that I know, and if you didn't, well, that's okay too. Sometimes I miss stuff where I'm completely incorrect, and if that's the case, please let me know in the comments so I can fix my brain. Here are some other videos that I've done, and there's more Trek and other content from me on my website, KellyPlanet.com. See you next time.